Unless you've been living under a rock lately, you've probably heard of DeepSeek. And in this video, I want to talk about what it is, why it's important, and how to get started with it. So first off, DeepSeek is a Chinese artificial intelligence company founded in 2023. Now, I first heard about it at the end of 2024 in December as their V3 model came out and it was producing some really good results. Now, fast forward to recent in January 2025, DeepSeek unveiled its AI model, DeepSeek R1, which demonstrated performance comparable to OpenAI's ChatGPT, but was developed at a fraction of the cost and computing power. So this is pretty important. DeepSeek had developed this R1 model at a fraction of the cost of all the other large language models, but was on par with a lot of them. So I want to start over here on X on DeepSeek's official account, and this came out on January 20th, 2025. DeepSeek R1 is here. Performance on par with OpenAI's O1 model. Here's where it's important. Fully open source model and technical report. MIT licensed, distill, and commercialize freely. So there's some information on chat.deepseek.com we'll get to in a second. There are some benchmarks, which we'll talk about in a second. But again, bonus, open source distilled models. Distilled from DeepSeek R1, 6 small models fully open sourced. We'll talk about those in a second as well. So we have all these models. We have this license updated. DeepSeek R1 is now MIT licensed for clear open access. This allows for the community to leverage those model weights and outputs. API outputs can now be used fine-tuning and distilling. So there are some technical highlights here. We're going to jump into this white paper in a second. But really important, the API access and pricing. Look at some of these prices. 14 cents for 1 million input tokens, $2.19 for 1 million output tokens. Some of this at which is like 107 times cheaper than some of the large language models out there. So it takes a lot less to train these models. And it also is a lot less for you as the consumer to use these models, and they're on par with some of the large language models. That's why this is very important. That's why you're hearing a lot of buzz about this. Now, there are some comments out there to the validity of some of the training pricing, but I'm not gonna get into that here. You can go ahead and do some research on your own and kind of look into that. But the pricing for right now in the initial offering is way cheaper than a lot of the large language models out there. So what I wanna do is jump into this. This is their R1 paper. You can find it over here. I'll leave a link to this and everything we go through in the description below. And it says, we introduced our first generation reasoning model. So this is DeepSeek R1.0. And it was trained via large-scale reinforcement learning, RL, with supervised fine-tuning as a preliminary step. So it goes in to some things, talking about the model. R1 achieves performance comparable to OpenAI's O1 model on reasoning tasks. So this is the ability to kind of think through some of the problem-solving and even correct itself as it's going. To support this, they've basically created 6 dense models, so 1.5 billion parameters, 7 billion, all the way up to 70 billion parameters. Those will become important because we'll talk about how you can run those on your own computer. Now, maybe not all of them, but that's why I'm really interested in NVIDIA's Project Digits. This is a supercomputer that can run on your desktop. It's very powerful. It says in here, I think, yeah, AI models up to 200 billion parameters locally. So once this comes out, I'm really excited to get my hands on one of these. So you could easily run like the 70 billion parameter DeepSeek R1 model on that. And that is exciting to me. Here's where it gets fun. So here are some benchmarks. And these are some of the leading benchmarks that all the other large language models kind of put out there as far as how they're doing whenever they release a new model. And you see DeepSeek R1 is this kind of blue with this dark blue with these diagonal lines through it. OpenAI's O1 is in gray. We have DeepSeek R1, OpenAI, and then DeepSeek again. So in this first one, we can see this is a mathematical, like a prestigious 15-question, 3-hour mathematics competition. We can see that DeepSeek R1 has a slight edge there. So it's doing really well in that category. In coding, it's doing on par with OpenAI's O1. In the GPQA, this is the graduate level Google Proof Q&A. This has benchmarks around complex graduate level multiple choice questions around biology, physics, and chemistry. We can see that it's doing really well there. Another kind of math test, general math questions, it does really well on that. In this MMLU, this is the massive multitask language MMLU benchmark. And this is to assess the performance of large language models across a diverse range of subjects. We could see that it's doing really well there as well. And then the SWE bench verified is across a number of GitHub problems and its ability to solve them. And again, we see that it's on par with OpenAI's O1 here. So again, training at a fraction of the cost, producing some really, really good results. So I think that's kind of what has got everyone really excited about this. So to get started with DeepSeek, you can head over to DeepSeek.com, learn a little bit more about that. We see DeepSeek R1 is now live. If you go ahead and go to Start Now, that'll take you over to the chat. We'll see that in a second. If you go over to the API platform, this is where you can learn more. You can go through the docs. You can get an API key. If you want to kind of build out some generative AI applications using DeepSeek, for all my fellow Java and Spring developers, we are going to do that in the next video. I want to just kind of go through some of the basics of DeepSeek in this one. But if you want to get started with DeepSeek, you can go to chat.deepseek.com. Now, again, this is similar to the product like ChatGPT. ChatGPT is the interface to the large language model like O1. This is the interface to their large language models V3 or R1 if you go ahead and select this button. This is going to do that reasoning. So remember that you are sending all of your data over to this particular company in this case. So just be mindful of that. But I want to go through a couple of questions here. For some reason, one of the benchmarks that we always talk about when we talk about some of these large language models and reasoning is to figure out how many R's are in the word strawberry. So let's go ahead and try that. How many R's are in the word strawberry? So it's going to take that. Now, again, this is a reasoning model. So you see it actually shows its thinking. Here's its thought process on trying to figure out the solution to this problem. It goes through, it shows you each of those, says, okay, let me go ahead and look at that. Wait, let me double check my work before I give you an answer. So it's actually thinking through this, double checking its work, and then it's going to give us an answer. Let's see what it says. Yep, okay, first R, second R, third R. There are three instances of the letter R in strawberries. So very good there. Now let's talk about another one. We know that it's very good at math problem solving, coding, those types of questions. So let's say create a new LEET code style coding problem and solve it. So this is going to say, hey, I want you to create a new one that maybe doesn't exist out there, and it's going to go through its thought process. So, okay, let me think about that. What is a LEET code style problem? How can we come up with something new, and how can I solve it? I've done this before in a quick example, and it went through and did a whole lot. So this might take a while. I might go ahead and fast forward this at some point, but as you can see, it's really thinking through this, and it's really interesting to like start to read through this and try to understand what it's doing here and how it's thinking about it. So it's trying to come up with this nice new LEET style code problem, and it's thinking through like, what is a good problem? Okay, if I do that problem, how do I solve for it? So it's given up the problem, then it's going to go through and try and solve for it. And eventually it will come down to a point where it says, okay, I can solve this, and it does it in code. All right, we have finished here. Now you can see here is the problem statement. So how to split a string with no adjacent duplicates. It goes through and gives you the problem statement. Like any LEET style code problem, it will give you some examples. So here's an input, here's what the output is, here's the explanation of that output. Has a few examples, here's some constraints. You may not have seen it, but somewhere through there it said, hey, let me talk through some of the edge cases. Here's the solution. To solve this problem, we use a dynamic programming combined with a pre-computed validity matrix to efficiently count valid splits. So here's the approach. Here is the code. It decided to write it in Python. here's how you solve for that. Here's my explanation of this, of the solution. I haven't actually gone through this. I'm just going to assume that this is correct. But that was really interesting to see its reasoning, to see its thinking about coming up with a new problem and then solving that. I thought that was really good. So you can go ahead and try DeepSeek out for free over at chat.deepseek.com. So again, if you don't want to pay big dollars for all the other large language models out there, I know I pay for ChatGPT, I pay for Google Gemini, I pay for Claude. This is an alternative. So you don't have to pay for those large language models, at least of right now. You can go ahead and use this. Now you will need to pay for the API if you want to use, you know, build generative AI applications using R1. But again, it's at a fraction of the cost of some of the large language models. And again, we'll cover that in a future video. Now, again, you're using the product, the chat product that sits on top of the large language model here. And again, we're sending all of our data. So anything we put in here, don't put in sensitive data or your own stuff, because that is getting sent to it. But what's really interesting is that this is an open source model, which means you can run it on your own machine if you wanted to. You can run it on other platforms, like Hugging Face has a bunch of, I think I saw like 200 variations of this model popped up in the first week, right? So you can run this over on Hugging Face if you want to, but you can also run this on your local machine. So the way that you can do this is by using something like Ollama, get up and running with large language models. And there are all kinds of different models that you can run that are open source. Llama is a big one from Meta. So they have Llama 3.3 is the latest model. You can see DeepSeek R1 here and many others. So the first thing you'll want to do is go ahead and download and install Llama. You can do that for macOS, Linux, or Windows. All right, so I'm installing it, moving it to applications, and it looks like it's been downloaded. Okay. All right, welcome to Ollama. We'll click next, install. And now you can run your first model. So I'm gonna go ahead and click finish, but what I wanna do is go over to models, and now we can pick from the different models. Again, I've run Llama 3.2, I believe is the last one on my previous machine that I had running. And now I'm gonna go ahead and check out DeepSeek R1. So it'll give you some information. It also tell you all of the models available. Again, we saw from the white paper that it distilled it down into different versions. This is the 1.5 billion parameter model all the way up to the 671 billion parameter model. You can see this drop down here. If you go in here, you can see how much space it's going to take on your computer. Now, even if you had 404 gigabytes available, unless you have a really, really massive machine, this is probably going to be tough to run. I've run the 8 billion parameter model over on a previous machine using the Llama 3.2 model. So I'm going to stick with the 7B. That's the one that was selected for me. And I'm going to go ahead and copy this command. Now what I can do is head over to a terminal and run this command, and basically it will use Ollama, figure out that I don't have that DeepSeek R1 7 billion parameter model installed yet, and then install it for me. So let's do that. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and run this command, and you can see that it's checking. Nope, I don't have that, so it's going to go ahead and download that model for me. Again, that's 4.7 gigabytes, so depending on your connection speed, this may take a couple of minutes, and through the magic of video editing, we'll kind of jump ahead to when this is downloaded. All right, and as we can see, that finished pulling, verifying, and success, and this should finish up, and we should be able to use our new model locally on our machine now. So send a message. I want to back out of this though. Let me just go ahead and quit. Exit, sorry. And what I want to do is just say Ollama list. We can list out all of the models that are installed. So if you had previous models like Llama 3.2 through Llama 3.3, those ones will be installed. So what I want to do now is go ahead and run that. So I can say Ollama run, and then you see DeepSeek R1 7B. So we can go ahead and click that. And now we can go ahead and send a message. So now, similar to the chat interface that sat on top of the model, we can send messages to the model and get a response. So how many R's are in strawberry? And it's gonna go through, and it actually shows out our thinking just as it did before. It's going through and it's trying to figure that out. There are 3 R's in the word strawberry. Great. So awesome. So now we can run this model locally on our machine. Everything that we're doing, if we wanted to like bring our own data, everything we're doing is localized to my machine. If I turned off my network now, this would still work. That's really exciting. Now, this particular interface may not be all that exciting to everyone, especially those of us who are used to using something like ChatGPT, right? So that was step one, being able to run it on our local machine. Now what I want to do is kind of give me an interface that I'm used to working with. So if you don't have it installed already, you'll want to install Docker. So get started. I think you can get away with not signing up for an account, but I have an account. I'm signed up for an account. I have Docker Desktop running on my machine because I use it for so many other things. But if you don't, you'll want to get Docker installed. And with that, you can use a project called the Open Web UI, which is going to give you this nice user interface that similar to, say, a ChatGPT that you're used to working with. And the way that you install it is by running this Docker command. So you can say, is Olama on your computer? Yes, it is. So we're going to use this command. So we're going to go ahead and close this, come back to our terminal, just paste that in and run this command. We'll allow Docker to run this. We'll see that it goes down, pulls that image or that container, if you will, and it will go ahead and grab that for us. All right, so you see that Open Web UI is here. It is running on localhost 3000. I'm going to go ahead and bring that up in a web browser. And localhost 3000 runs to auth. Let's go ahead and get started. So enter your full name. Say Dan Vega, danvega@gmail.com. Now, I've done this on a previous computer, so I wonder if this is going to let me still create this account here, and it does. Okay, so there's what's new in Web UI. So now, once you open this Web UI, now it's going to read from Olama there and figure out are all of the models that you have running on your machine. Now, I only have one model, which is that Deepseek R1 7 billion parameter, but now I get this nice user interface that I can go ahead and ask my questions to or give my prompts to. So, all right, so let's just ask it for a simple coding example. Can you write a simple Java application that asks the user for their name and then prints it out to the console? Let's see if we can do that. It's going to go through, can show its thinking. Now, again, remember, probably not the best use case for some simple scenarios like this because it is a reasoning model. It's going to go through and think about this. So probably better for more complex tasks, things it needs to reason with. In this case, it's actually thinking about how it's going to solve the problem that you asked it. But at the end of the day, you'll get a simple simple class here. What's the name input? It uses a scanner class, says, please enter your name. Assigns the name to a variable based on whatever is inputted and then prints this out to the console. But more importantly, you get some reasoning behind it, like why did it do what it did? And then we get some step-by-step explanations of line by line, what is going on in this class, just in case you wanted to see it. And then we see the example output at the bottom. So again, this is really helpful. We were able to install an open source large language model like DeepSeek's R1 using Olama. You can use that from the command line, but always probably not the most friendliest UI, right? So we went over to Open Web UI, installed that via Docker, using Docker Desktop. And now we have this nice chat interface that we can use locally on our machine to ask a large language model any of the questions that we want with some reasoning. And this is completely free and completely open source. All right, so that's it for today's tutorial. I wanted to talk about what DeepSeek is because it has been all the rage this week, and rightfully so, making some big moves as a large language model at a fraction of the costs for training that large language model, a fraction of the cost for using it if you want to use it in your applications. Again, if you are a Java programmer, if you're a Spring programmer, we are going to go through how to use that API in your Java and your Spring applications in the next video. I wanted to kind of give a level set and just kind of talk about in general what DeepSeek is and how to get started with it in this video. So I hope you found this useful. If you did, do me a big favor, friends. Leave me a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and as always, happy coding.